Hi, it's Heather Brooke. I'm a writer and campaigner for freedom of information. I'm also a dual citizen and worked in America as well.
Here I am.
I have two questions. One about injunctions and super injunctions. As these are such draconian powers on stifling free speech, why is it that they are not recorded anywhere publicly so that we can at least get some understanding of the extent to which these powers are used? And I know that they're not, I've looked into that. And also the second question is, do you have any estimate as a provider on most libel cases what the overall cost is in lawyer's fees in the libel business, in libel, in your courts, in a year, lawyer's fees?
So I realise being around the room, but because I didn't recognise you compared to the person who portrayed you on television. So, in fact, super injunctions, I think, is something of an artificial construct thrown out by the media recently. I've never heard the term until it was mentioned a few months ago in Parliament. I'm not conscious that I've ever granted one, but it's conceivable that I might have. The obvious example for them, their use is something which does come out in front of me occasionally, regularly, but occasionally. That is where a celebrity is being blackmailed by somebody, normally a former girlfriend or boyfriend, someone who says, I'm going to sell that story to the press unless you pay me £100,000 or £200,000, and sometimes they actually pay up to these people. Then the person will go into hiding, and you can't pay up, you can't serve them with the proceedings. So the purpose of a super, what's now called a super injunction, in those circumstances, would be to ensure that the person in question, culprit, doesn't find out about the existence of the injunction and rush off the newspapers before it's served on them, so it can avoid contempt of court proceeding. I think I've been asked this question several times in the law courts as to how we can lay our hands on the statistics. The trouble is, when a judge grants an anonymous injunction, it's recorded anonymously, and you can't find out the facts, you can't find out the details. The only thing we could do, I think, is to invite judges over a limited period of time to just list the number of super injunctions they grant, if they do. That's all one could do. One couldn't break into the confidentiality. I think we find it's a tiny number. As I said, I can't actually remember any part of one, and I might have one or two in the past. The next aspect of your question, I think, was costs. I simply have no statistics to offer us. The cost is huge, I'm sure of that. We're about to start eventually, because there's been a bit of a time lag, the pilot scheme to investigate cases which were issued after the 1st of October last year, suggested by Lord Justice Jackson. It's only just beginning to filter through. And there may be a case or two coming up in the near future to try and see if we can limit to some extent the cost of proceedings. I've been to one or two training sessions with the cost judges, and it doesn't throw very much light on it, because the solicitors will generally come up with the cost of travelling to Ethiopia to take a witness today. It's fairly uncontroversial. That's what an airfare costs. We're spending X hours on disclosure of documents, that's what it costs. Sometimes one suspects that there may be overcharging in the sense that more hours are spent on handling documents than strictly necessary. It's very difficult to establish that that's the case. I suspect that's the most frequent challenge which arises.